Good morning. Good to see you. Welcome to First Presbyterian, the worship at 9 on this second Sunday of Advent. We're also welcoming all those who are watching us online to worship today. Our theme is Make Room for Worship, and we'll get into that as we go along in the service. Please fill in your connection card. There's a little connection card in front of you in a pew. Please fill those in and drop it in the box with your offerings as you leave. We're still encouraging you to get in your Gift to God cards for the year. You can drop those in the box. You can mail those. You can drop by the office. You can stop me in the street. You can do whatever you need to do. But you can get those in as early as possible. It gives us an idea to plan our budgets for 2023. But your support, as always, has been amazing. It's been great, and we're praying for even greater things in the future. Next Saturday, the Christmas Open House is hosted by Pastor Christy and Guy at their home at 3010B Nutmeg Lane from 1 to 6 p.m. So if you're out and about, drop in and visit there. It's just a relaxed time to say hello and to get some refreshments and just to have plenty of chat over that Christmas period. Pastor Christie's leading our Blue Christmas worship service that we've been talking about on Wednesday, December 14th at 7 p.m. Blue Christmas is for anybody in the community who have lost someone, who are mourning and just struggling with loss. And it's just a quiet, contemplative service where they can come in the quiet and just be here in the presence of God. So if you know anybody that you could bring along and support and help them through that, that would be wonderful. It's at 7 o'clock, December the 14th. And then next Sunday night is our FPC Round the Table Carol singing for all the family. It's a good, fun evening down in the gym. Plan to be there, bring others with you. It's great to be together as a whole church family. There'll be activities for the kids. We hope that there's some new families that you can bring and will come along. All you need to do is bring your tableware. Not, you don't need to bring a table. Just need to bring your plate and disposable stuff. You bring a candle for the table and a side dish to share. We will supply all the fried chicken you can eat and wassail and cookies. And it's just a good night. Starts at 5, usually over 6:30-ish. So come along down in the gym. That's next Sunday at 5 p.m. Now I want to invite AJ and Taylor to come forward, and they're going to light the Advent wreath, and then we'll have our call to worship video. And we can hear singing in the background.
Fire burns, it hurts, it destroys. Fire also gives warmth and light. The coming of Christ is both a day of judgment and a day of promise. Two candles flicker brightly to help us remember that the coming Christ has many meanings.
Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky.
Light two candles, see them glow brightly, so that all may know how the candles show the way, making our darkness bright as God's day.
Dear God, we have much to do, and we are not sure we will be ready for the day of your coming. In Advent's light, help us to see what is important, to be who you want us to be, and to do what you would have us do. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
I'd invite you to stand with us. And as we, you know, this today is our theme is all about worship. And worship is not all about just singing, but it's a great part of it. So let's just celebrate as we sing. And it doesn't matter whether you can, whether you sing out of tune. It doesn't matter. As long as you're making a noise to God, He appreciates that. Because I think He has a little filter and He turns it into sounding really good. That's just what I gather anyway. I don't think God ever sits with His fingers in His ears going, oh, that sounds awful. He just delighted that we're worshiping Him. This is called He Shall Reign Forevermore.
Forevermore, and He shall reign forevermore.
us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you let's just pray, and then we're going to watch our video.
Oh, I need you.
Or we could watch the video and then we could pray, whatever. Let's just pray for a second, and then I swap things around on them, so I've made things complicated as usual. Let's just pray. Lord, we just thank you for today. We thank you for this season of Advent. We thank you that in the busyness of everything that surrounds us, we can take this moment to just be with you. Open our hearts and our minds. Let us hear from you. Stir our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, I need you.
Morning.
Morning.
How are you?
Good.
Have you done much worshiping this week? Or have you been grouchy? Like, not that you're ever grouchy.
No.
Sorry. Yeah. But
I can do both.
Yeah. We all can, can't we?
Yeah. I had an interesting worship moment at Pottery yesterday.
Okay.
Yeah. True story. I was, Guy and I do spend pottery classes in Wichita on Saturdays. And yesterday, I'm very tired this morning. My brain is all, and we were at Pottery yesterday, and there was this guy I'd never seen before who was talking to the owner of the studio, and he said, oh, something about, she said, I haven't seen you in a while, and I'd never seen him, and she said, I haven't seen you in a while, and she said, how are things going? He said, well, things at church are finally okay, and I went barreling up, and I said, what's wrong at your church? And she said,
that's called nosy pastor.
Yes. And she said to him, oh, Christy's a pastor too. And I said, oh, you're a pastor? And he said, yeah, I'm the associate pastor at United Methodist Church down the street. And he said, you? And I said, yeah, the pastor at First Presbyterian in Hutchinson. And so we fist bumped. And then we were immediately, like, you know, bonded.
Okay.
And so, you know, we talked about church stuff and God. And so it was just a little bonding moment, you know. And so we spent some time talking. And yeah, so it was just like a little worship moment there in Pottery. And so, you know, they could have put a pottery studio up there.
They could.
Yeah, so it was nice.
It's really hard at times, you know, to think when you see that video and you've seen all the different places and you're asked, did you worship God here?
Mm-hmm.
And you think, no.
Mm-hmm.
At least that's what I think.
Yeah.
You know, not speaking for everybody else. Because you probably did worship him in all those places. We know that. You're so good.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't. I know I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
I thought of the car park, you know. And I thought, you know, usually I don't worship God there.
Right.
I'm usually angry because people don't put, I'm going to get on a little. I get really angry when people don't bring their carts back to the trolley park.
Mm.
And the wind's howling at 40 miles an hour and they come across and they put their thing down, their cart down, and they walk away and the cart starts rolling down and they think, for goodness sake, take that and put it back.
That's
so I'm not really worshiping.
Do you want us to pray for you?
Yeah, please.
That's really sad.
Because it's one of those things. I got really annoyed on Friday, I think it was. Jennifer will know it or not, because this guy did that, and he walked around the front of his van and set the trolley basically right in front of our car, and he walked further around his car to leave it there, and the trolley park was just sitting right behind him. He could actually just pushed it into it. And I thought, so that irritates me in this.
I'm getting that.
You get that?
Yeah.
So there's not much worship going on there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's a real challenge when we think that every aspect of our life we should be worshiping God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and probably, have we any K State fans here?
Yeah.
Apparently, they won a 4-hour game yesterday. Who plays for 4 hours, for goodness sake? 4 hours it took.
I'm waiting for you to bring, how long are we going to circle the airport before you make a point here?
Well, I bet you nobody was worshiping God in front of that TV, apart from when it went into overtime. And everybody dropped to their knees and prayed, Lord, let us win this in overtime. But there are, isn't it? You know, to say that we worship God all the time,
mm-hmm.
or we're supposed to,
mm-hmm.
virtually impossible.
That's true.
Because we're just human.
Yes, that's true.
But it doesn't mean we shouldn't try.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Right.
Will that do us?
Well, it doesn't mean that we should worship God every moment, although Paul says in 1 Thessalonians we should pray without ceasing.
Which again is really difficult.
It is. But I think the point is that when God lives in our hearts, that, you know, we are worshipful all the time. You know, we can constantly live in a state of worship. You know, worshiping all the time, but living in a state of worship, that we are worshipful with our lives.
Yeah.
You know, we live in a state of worship, meaning that we live in a way that glorifies God.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean?
I'm going to try that in the QR part.
You try that. See that person as being made in the image of God, because you have never met a person God doesn't love.
So when I see him not putting his cart back, just say,
God loves you,
God
you knothead.
You lay about. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
Let me read to you. Let's get into some scripture. And let me read to you from Philippians 4 and verses 4 to 9. This is from the Message. Celebrate God all day, every day. And I mean actually revel in him. Take it as clear as you can to all you meet that you're on their side, working with them and not against them. Help them see that the Master is about to arrive. He could show up any minute. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worry and pray, let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good, will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. Summing it all up, friends, I'd say you'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things that are true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst, the beautiful, not the ugly, things to praise, not things to curse. Put into practice what you have learned from me, what you heard and saw and realized. Do that, and God, who makes everything work together, will work you into the most excellent harmonies. I love that reading. It's a real challenging reading. I love that video that we watch, because it does challenge every aspect of our lives. And we all, I think, have to say with hand on heart, we're not too good at worshiping God outside of this place or a place of worship in the main. You know, we forget about God because there's so many other things. You know, I'm distracted by this man in his cart, as I said, or I'm distracted about something else. I'm distracted when I'm trying to drive in, or I'm sitting at a traffic light waiting to go, sitting behind somebody, and they don't move off for ages because they're having a conversation on their phone. And I'm not worshiping God. I'm not actually thinking, okay, God, it's all right. This is okay. We live in this world that's so about ourselves and where we can go and what we have to do that we forget about this whole concept of worship and what actually worship means and what it's meant to mean. Worshiping God at home, in work, in school, on a sports field, in the supermarket, in your car, in the line at the grocery store, is something that probably doesn't come that easy to most of us, I would guess. For a long time, I didn't realize that my life was supposed to be a living example 24/7 of who God wanted me to be. That I was supposed to be worshiping him by the way I lived my life. For many people today, this word worship and praise have become just about music with songs. Yet if that's the way we think, then we're selling worship short, because that's not what God means. And of course, music is a great way to offer up praise to God. And I love it. Love worship. I love a worship time. But worship is much more, I discovered a long time ago, than a catchy tune or a melody that sticks in your head. God has woven a desire into our DNA to worship. Think about that, how true that is. There are so many people today worshiping K-State, and rightly so. Well done. There's those who are wishing that KU could be as good as K-State in football. Reversed probably for basketball. We worship the Royals and the Chiefs. We set our timers, the Chiefs are on this afternoon, nothing else is going to happen. We worship money and success. It's just what we do. It's just who we are. There's this desire to worship. But it's really difficult for us to think that when I go out on the street, when I go about my everyday life, when I go to school, when I talk to people in the supermarket, my life is supposed to be lived in worship of my God. Now, none of this is easy. We're human. But it's what we're supposed to strive to be. And the big question that I had to wrestle with was my worship to God going to be a Sunday-only worship or a 24/7 worship? Because for a long time, my worship of God was a Sunday worship, whatever that meant, whether it was an hour-long service, an hour and a half, whether it was two worship services. And I eventually chose the 24/7 route. Took a long time. Do I always get it right? I've already told you I don't get it right. But I strive to do that, and it's helped to shape my life and to see things differently, to see people differently. So how about you today? How about you? Let's be real honest, because we all know God knows what the answer should be from each of us. But let's be real honest to ourselves. Are you a Sunday worshiper? Or are you a 24/7 worshiper? Each of us have been created to be in a relationship with God, with our whole self, every fiber of our being given to Him. We need to make room for Jesus. We need to make room for worship. Our lives should be overflowing with worship to our God, and people should see that. Today, Scripture tells us that we are to revel. Not often we use that word anymore, but to revel in God, to celebrate Him every day with every breath that we take. And when we do that, it says God makes everything work in perfect harmony. Wow. I would love to live in a world that was in perfect harmony with what God wanted, but we don't. Our lives are to be like a catchy melody all the time. You know that tune that sticks in your head? Have you got one of those? You know, you hear it on the radio, and every time you get into the car, you seem to hear the same song. And when you go to bed at night and you close your eyes, that song's going over and over in your head. Everybody have one of those? No? Yeah, bless us. I'm a strange person. You're not supposed to nod, Christy, and agree with that. But you know the way, there's just tunes and melodies that stick in your head, and God should be like that for us, that He's never far from us, that He's always playing that tune, that God tune in our lives. And others see that there's something different. There's something different. That's how we're supposed to worship God. That's why we need to make room for God, because we're so busy. There's no room for Him. God, we have so many other things going on at the minute. Our schedules are crazy. But we'll make room for you on Christmas Day. After we've had our big dinner and we slump down in a seat and basically fall asleep, I'll make room for you at some stage. But we need God's to be the anthem of our life. We need God to be sung every time we open our mouths. Not that we have to sing to everybody. It's not a musical. You know, I don't want you going up to somebody and start, you know, "Hello, how are you today?" That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about that everything that we say reflects Jesus, that honors Him. And it's a real struggle. If anybody has got this worked out, would you please come and talk to me afterwards? Because it's so difficult. It's so difficult. Worship should capture every dimension of our life. It should be our heart, it should be our soul, it should be our mind, and it's united in the most beautiful harmony of worship to God. Or is it? True worship isn't a single, simple act of a song or a praise. Just as it isn't only an event that we attend on a Sunday morning or a Sunday evening. True worship becomes a lifestyle. That's what God's looking us to do, to create room for him in our lives as we prepare for Christmas, for the coming of his son. We need to make room in our lives. So like the angels worshipped him on that first Christmas, and the shepherds and the wise men came and worshipped him, that's how we need to have our lives sorted, so that we are worshiping him with every breath that we take. Worship exists in our very DNA, as I said earlier. And this is the bit that really struck me of how I lived my life for so long. My act of worship to God was an hour a week on a Sunday, usually. Usually a bit longer. Our worship services would go on a lot longer. But that was it. And one day it really struck me that if that's all I think God deserves from me, there's something seriously wrong. If my focus and my worship to God happens for an hour and 30 minutes, or whatever it is on a Sunday, and he's forgotten about when I walk out the doors, there's something seriously wrong. And there was something wrong in my life. I hadn't let Jesus and God capture my heart so that everything that I did, I knew came from him. I knew that everything that happened was because he ordained it to happen. I knew that every breath that I took was because he allowed me to take that breath. You know, there's no such thing as having a part of your life in worship and the rest of your life separated from that. There's no such thing. We are to be living sacrifices, living worshipers of our God, or else we're not. As followers of Jesus, we're called to be living our lives, our entire lives, as a worship to the one who came from heaven as a baby, to be born in a lowly, smelly stable with no pomp and ceremony, because he loved you and me so much. Romans 12, 1 to 2 says this: therefore I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is our spiritual service of worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may approve that God, what God's will is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Two such powerful verses. They were written near the end of the Apostle Paul's life. They're so powerful and they can be so life-changing. You have to notice the first word was therefore. And when that word is like a red, it should be like a red flag for us. It should get our attention. And when we see the word, we should always stop and find out what the therefore is actually there for. It's supposed to make us stop. You see, in the first 11 chapters of Romans, Paul was laying out his theology of who God was and what God had done. And now in chapter 12, he was hitting with the response should be, live your lives for him. That we should be a light of God's love, offering ourselves up, our whole selves, as living sacrifices in worship to the King of Kings. That's our purpose. That's our purpose in life. Not to go through the mundane, not to just go through what everybody else is going through. Not having this schedule that's directed by TV and the world and people around us, but what's directed from Scripture and directed from God himself. We're to offer up our friends, our family, our hopes, our dreams, our careers and ambitions, our possessions, our time and our money. Everything we have is given in worship to God, who gave us everything that we have. Our spiritual act of worship is our whole lives given to him. A whole and complete life set apart to be different. By living differently from the world around us, from breaking the patterns of the world and the culture that surrounds us, we show Jesus to a waiting world and an unbelieving world. Look, our life is to be our worship. It's plain and simple. When we become followers of Christ, there should be no part of us that exists outside of our life in Christ. We need to let Jesus invade our whole lives. That's what I discovered. I wanted to invade little pockets of it, little boxes of it, little parts of it, and let me keep the rest. It was only when you surrender yourself and say, Jesus, have all of this messy person that I am, and turn it into something good. Turn it into what a life that's lived for the purposes you made me to be. Then things start to fall into place. Then my life becomes a little bit more like a life that's worshiping him 24/7. He transforms every area of your life. You see, if you let him invade every area, that means every area. Even the bits that we know are wrong, but we want to hold on to because we think we enjoy them. And yet we know they're not doing us any good. Jesus leaves nothing unaltered or untouched when we let him in. Now that's worship. When we say, Jesus, here's, take all of me. Our video, that song that went on, I need you. That's what we need. That's the tune that we need going on in our heads every day of our lives. We need you, Jesus. We need you as we wake up and we start another day. We need you through all this chaos. Just look at how the Christmas season has been shaped by the world around us. You know, some people are more excited that the Hallmark Christmas movie season had started and they can get 24/7 Christmas movies. And Jesus never comes into the equation. It's all about the season. They forget about the reason for the season, the reason why we celebrate this holiday. And if we can place Jesus at the center of our lives this Christmas and beyond, the festivities and the celebrations would take on a whole new meaning. There'd be a true display of our worship of him, the baby, who came to change the world. This is not going to happen overnight. You just don't flick a switch and it happens. We have to work at it. It takes commitment. Something we need to strive for every day, and we fail every day, and we get up and we try it again. There are no shortcuts to being a Christian. Anybody that said that become a Christian and your life will get easy is telling you lies. We just read scripture and we know that anybody that followed Jesus didn't have an easy life, but they had a fulfilled life. They had Jesus walking beside them. They had God looking over them. They had the Holy Spirit living within them. Becoming a follower of Jesus isn't the end of our story, it's the beginning of our story. Letting Jesus into every aspect of our lives is the beginning of a life to be lived to the full. That's when the real work starts. That's when the change of our lifestyle and focus starts to happen, when we turn our eyes on Jesus. And it's going to take commitment. The question is, are we up for that this Advent? Are we up to change? Are we up to make room through all the aspects of our lives so that we can live a life that worships him? My hope and prayer is that God will speak into each of our lives, into our hearts, and reveal how your life can be honoring and lived in worship of him. He wants to give you life to the full. And that comes when we surrender ourselves, and can I say, surrender our schedules to him. That's just another act of worship, saying, God, you have my schedule. Make it right. Let me have time for you. Living a life of worship is the pathway towards realizing what good life really is, what a great life is when you follow Jesus Christ. So I think we need to take a real hard look at the purpose of our lives and the worship and decide what we're going to do here. We're going to make God and Jesus the foundation and the center of our lives so that he can transform us so that others can see. It's well known that the things you love the most will be at the center of how you structure your priorities for life. And what is it is that you worship the most? Martin Luther said many, many, many years ago, whatever your heart clings to and confides in, that is really your God. Now that's just God in lowercase g, not the God who came to the world in a stable in Bethlehem. We have all these gods in our lives. And whatever our heart clings to is what shapes our lives. So this morning, I want to plead with you to cling to Jesus. And you can say to me, I do, I'm here. I cling to Jesus. I want you to cling to him tomorrow, and Tuesday and Wednesday, and Thursday and Friday, and Saturday. And when we come back to worship, we'll have lived a week of worship. Worship to him. Because we're worshiping an amazing, a wonderful, a spectacular, and a marvelous God. That's the true magic of Christmas, you know. We always talk about the magic of Christmas. The true magic of Christmas is that God loved us so much that he would send his son to this earth to die for us. And if that doesn't mean we want to make room for him, there's something seriously wrong. The God of the universe, the creator of everything, sent his son because of his love for you and for me. That is the gift of Christmas and the reason why he deserves our worship with every breath that we take. Let's pray. Lord, we're just going to take a moment of silence. In that stillness, we want to recognize our need for more of you. Help us to cling to you. Take hold of our lives, Lord. Help us to invite you in and say, here we are, take us, use us. Help us to walk out these doors a different person and not leave what we have heard you say to us or how we have felt in our hearts, not leave them here in a pew, but take them with us for the rest of the day and for tomorrow and the rest of the week and the months and the years that lie ahead. You deserve our worship. So come, Lord Jesus. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Give us what we need to live lives that worship you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Let's stand. We're going to sing a couple of songs to finish. As I said, God wants us to have a life that's lived to the full. And when we worship God, let's worship him with all of our lives and with all of our hearts. And I know we're Presbyterian, but you can, you know, clap your hands and you can stamp your feet and you can even stand up in a pew and wave your arms about. And some people might think you're weird, but I'll smile at you and say, good on you. Because we just worship this God and we get so excited. And I would hazard a guess that when all the K-State fans, when that final field goal went between the posts, they didn't sit there and go, okay, that was all right. But I bet you, if it's like us or me watching soccer, I would have said football, but then I would have confused you, soccer, and you get really excited. You scream and you shout and you jump up and you punch the air. We had a young man that visited our house when I was doing youth work at home, and I was away at a camp, and he was down watching, I think it was a Wimbledon final, and it was a big long final, and Nadal or somebody won at the end, and he jumped up, and he was about 6'2", and he punched the air, and he knocked our light off the ceiling. So I came home to these people, this 6'2" person standing holding this light and saying, have you screws to get in here? See, we get excited about things. It's time to get excited about God. This is called House of the Lord. clap. Yep, that's it. Amazing. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. And our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause He hung up on that cross and He rose up from that grave. And my God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Again, we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Now God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We'll shout out your praise. Our final song is called The Goodness of God. Please join us for coffee out the back. Don't just rush off. Let's stand. I'll get down to the back as quick as I can. We can have a conversation.
Love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice.
Remember that in all our lives, God has been faithful. All our lives, He's been so good. And with every breath that we are able, let us sing of the goodness of God. Let's worship Him. Have a wonderful week. And we'll see you back here next week. And remember, around the table next Sunday night.